Finger off.
All right. Right now, I want you guys to go into your Google Docs, and I want you to create a new Google Doc. Okay, we're in our new unit right now. The entire unit is the Civil War and Reconstruction. So go to Google Doc, create the new Google Doc, and title it Civil War. Unit 4, Civil War. Go back to your canvas real quick, and one last thing, I want you guys to click on the first Padlet. On the first Padlet, I want you guys to answer the questions without looking at your notes or your worksheet from yesterday. So this is called retrieval practice. What I want you guys to do is, from the reading, I want you to list the reasons for the causes of the Civil War. I want you to list the reasons that we, after reading your worksheet and the information that we looked at yesterday, I want you guys, to the best of your ability, recall the information that gives us why we went to war, why the North and South broke out in conflict. Make sure you guys write your names in the front. I'm gonna give you about 2 to 3 minutes to work on it. Tanner, let's delete that one, and I want you to write your real one. All right, so we are learning some of the information is the Fugitive Slave Law. Sarah, can you explain to me what the Fugitive Slave Law is? Or Fugitive Slave Act? Nope. Fugitive, what does that mean? People on the run are trying to hide from the law. So the Fugitive Slave Act would be what, Sarah?
Trying to stop
slaves from running. Ryder, want to expound on that?
Well, wasn't it like a slave in the South, like ran to the North, they had to like return them?
Correct. So if a civilian, right, so predominantly white males or women, if they found a slave or were helping a slave run away from the South, then they themselves are breaking the law. So what ended up happening is, if a slave ran to the North and you saw them and you knew that they were running away, it is your job to capture them. It is your job to tell the police. It is your job to stop them from running away. Let's see, what else? Chance is saying the Missouri Compromise, the Fugitive Slave Act. Chance, you want to explain to me what the Missouri Compromise is?
Missouri Compromise was
the line?
Yeah.
The parallel line? The North and the South on top. So what does that signify, though? Okay, so if the top of North was free states and the bottom was slave states, the Missouri Compromise did what? What was it a potential upset the balance of?
Well, Well, the 15 and 15? The 15 non-slave?
It was 12, yeah, it was 12. So 11 northern states were free, and 11 southern states were slaves, right? Slave states. Missouri wanted to become a slave state, and that would upset the balance 12 to 11 and give too much power to the slave states. So Massachusetts, which also contained Maine at the time, split. Maine became its own state. Massachusetts continued to be its own state, both of which are free, totaling 12 and 12 once again. Okay? And then finally, we start seeing the election, the Dred Scott Act, a lot of good stuff. All right, so now we can get into it. Okay, during this lecture, you guys should be able to, at the end of it, explain multiple causes of conflict. Evaluate the short and long-term impacts of conflicts and their resolutions. Explain how different labor systems developed and affected societies over time. And then finally, you will examine how historically marginalized groups have been affected. Right now is going to be your first bullet point. Reason number one for the North and South to go to war is called sectionalism. Okay, write down sectionalism as cause number one. So we see the line on the top being the North or the Union, and on the bottom South or the Confederacy. We see the American flag at the time on top and the Confederate flag or the battle flag on the bottom. So in your first bullet point, I want you guys to put sectionalism is cause number one. Now, sectionalism, what does that mean? Sectionalism is the idea that the excessive devotion to local interests and customs to a region of a nation. The intense feelings of sectionalism further divided the country into two separate sections, the North and South. So let's look at it from today's terms. Where do we see sectionalism today?
Politics.
Politics. We see sectionalism in politics today by particularly what?
The political parties.
The political parties. One of which being what? Okay, the Democrats and the Republicans. You're going to see that during the 1820s, sectionalism, or the North and South, the North always voted with the North, and the South always voted with the South. And it was almost like they had a devotion to each other, that in order to preserve their way of life, they under no circumstances would vote for the other side. We see a lot of that today, where Democrats will only vote for Democrats with a few exceptions, and Republicans will only vote according to Republican lines with a few exceptions. Now, sectionalism. Let's talk about what makes just the North and South different from one another. What was Southern states, what do they look like?
Weren't they like farms or something, agricultural areas?
Lots of agricultural areas, farmland, expanse of maybe plantations and things like that. What did the North look like?
Industrial
places. There were cities. There was largely diverse populations of individuals. And everybody ended up working in industrial complexes. They worked in big manufacturing places. Now, did the North need slaves? Did the South need slaves? Yes. And that was the ginormous difference between the two. So with sectionalism, prior to the Civil War, the United States was not united. Our country was more like two separate countries living within the same land. The United States was divided from North and South. The North had a very different outlook than the South. And because of that, it seemed like each section was their own nation. They just happened to live in the same borders. Does that make sense to you guys? So, not being united, living within the same borders, do you guys already see this conflict? And it's not even a conflict with war or battles or anything. Politically, there would be conflict. Ideologically, there would be conflict. They would have disagreements with multiple things, not just slavery. The North had industries, large cities, and diverse populations, and favored the politics of the Republican Party, which supported the abolition of slavery. People in large cities do not need extra individuals to work. People in large cities work themselves. So if you lived in a city, you lived in probably a smaller house or an apartment or townhouses or shacks. And you go to work every day to make sure you can make a living to pay for your food, your shelter, and any other necessities at the time. The North was what we kind of see a lot of the United States is today, where people within cities, large populations, go to work every day in large buildings. Which is completely different than the South. The South had large farm expanses and agricultural hubs. They had small amounts of individuals owning land and large amount of slaves working the land. Southerners even felt like they were different than Northerners in the sense of what they identified themselves as. People from the North were Americans, and that's what they are from the North and they are American. But Southerners first claimed the state that they are from.